This lesson is on the chain rule, or taking derivatives of composite functions. So if we are given a composite function, which is y is equal to f of g of x, then the derivative of this, y prime, is the derivative of the f prime with the g of x in there times the g prime of x. So we can write this in another way. If y is equal to f of g of x and u is equal to g of x, then we can figure out that dy dx is dy du du dx. This is where dy du is equal to f prime at u and du dx is equal to the g prime, which we just said previously. So what we want to do is kind of peel an orange, an onion, whatever you want to think of this as, and that will be how we will use the chain rule. We will be peeling away at our functions. Let's try just a word problem and to get this nailed down a little bit more. Suppose the length L in centimeters of a steel bar depends on the air temperature, which is H degrees centigrade, and that H depends on time, which is hours, and you can see that composite idea forming. One is dependent on another. If the length increases by 2 centimeters for every degree increase in the temperature, and the temperature is increasing at 3 degrees centigrade per hour, how fast is the length of the bar increasing? So we have two things happening here. The length increases by 2 centimeters for every degree, and the temperature is increasing at 3 degrees centigrade per hour. So we know that the rate of increasing in length is 2, the rate of increasing in temperature is 3, so the total rate change is really a dL dt, which is equal to the dL dh times dh dt. And this first one is the increase in the length, and the other one is the increase in the temperature. And of course they are multiplied together, so we can multiply the 2 times the 3 and get 6 and get the rate of increase for the length. That is how we use our composite function. Conclusion. The chain rule is used to determine instantaneous rate of change of functions, which means instantaneous rate of change means the first derivative, which depend on other functions. And that means we are dealing again with composite functions, f of g of x's. So let's try some examples. The first one says f of x is equal to cosine of e to the x. There's our g of x function, the e to the x, and the cosine is the f of x function. So our f prime of x is equal to the derivative of the cosine, which is negative sine. And of course, we carry along the e to the x. And then we take the derivative of the inside, which is e to the x, and the derivative of e to the x is e to the x. So our final answer should be cleaned up to negative e to the x sine e to the x. Again, we took the derivative on what we call the outside f function and made derivative of cosine negative sine. And then we went inside and took the derivative on e to the x, which indeed was e to the x. Let's try another one. F of x is equal to the square root of sine x. Well, we can see that the outside function is a power function, something to the 1/2 power. And the inside function is our sine x. So to do this problem, f prime of x is equal to the outside being quantity to the 1/2. So we take that derivative first, 1/2, whatever is in the parentheses, to the negative 1/2. Then we go inside the parentheses and take the derivative on the sine, and that derivative is cosine. So again, outside first and then inside, and we can clean this up, cosine x over 2 square roots of sine x. Let's try another example. F of x is equal to 1 over the square root of x squared minus 3. Well, again, the outside is to the negative 1/2 power, and inside is x squared minus 3. So if we do f prime of x on this one, We do the outside first, which is negative 1/2 x squared minus 3. It's the negative 3/2. And then we go inside to our g of x function and take the derivative on that, which is 2x. Because the 3, of course, its derivative is 0. Clean this up, and we have negative x. And we can keep the x squared minus 3 to the negative 3/2 in the numerator or put it in the denominator. It doesn't matter usually which way you finish these off. Let's go to another example. This one says y is equal to 2 to the 2x squared power plus 1 quantity to the fifth. Again, the outside is to the fifth power. The inside is the 2 to the 2x squared plus 1. So y prime is equal to 5, power rule again, 2 to the 2x squared plus 1 to the 4th. Go inside, finish off our chain rule, take the derivative of 2 to the 2x squared, which is 2 to the 2x squared, ln of 2. Now we have another chain rule going, and the fact that we have to take the derivative of 2x squared, which is 4x. And of course, the derivative on the 1 is 0. So we did more or less a double chain rule, one inside the other. Once we got to the 2x squared, we had to take the derivative of that. So cleaning this up, we get 4 times 5 is 20x. 2 to the 2x squared, ln of 2, times 2 to the 2x squared plus 1, all to the 4th power. A little more complicated than the others because we had to do the chain rule twice. And the more familiar you get to doing this without putting u's in, and if you notice, I have not showed you substitution in this at all. I've just done it as the chain rule is peeling off the different parts of the composite functions. Let's try an example that uses product rule as well as your chain rule. So if we want the prime on this, it's y prime equal. Now we have to use product rule, so it's going to be the x times the derivative of sine of 1 over x. Now on the sine of 1 over x, the outside is the sine, and the inside is 1 over x. So we first take the derivative of sine, which is cosine, of 1 over x. Then we go inside and take the derivative of 1 over x, which is negative 1 over x squared. Again, double chain rule in this one. And, of course, end up with the product rule again, plus the sine of 1 over x times the derivative of x, which is 1. And cleaning this up, we can see we can reduce a little bit here. So we will have negative cosine of 1 over x plus sine of 1 over x. A little more complicated because we have product rule in there, but again, peel, peel, peel away. Here's another example with product rule. We have e to the sine of x squared times ln of x cubed. So if we want this derivative, again we use product rule on the two different functions. We will say e to the sine of x squared, and then take the derivative of ln of x cubed, which is 1 over x cubed times 3x squared. Add to that ln of x cubed times the derivative of e to the sine of x squared times the derivative of sine of x squared, which is cosine of x squared, times the derivative of x squared, which is 2x. So we had to do a lot of peeling to get this particular derivative. Remember, we did first the e function, because that was the outside one. Once that was stripped away, we did the derivative on the sine, got that stripped away, and then finally did the derivative on x squared, which became 2x. And if you notice, again, it was e to the sine of x squared, not e to the x or anything simple. No, we took the sine of x squared fully. And when we got to the cosine part, we said x squared again. And until we got to the x squared and actually took its derivative, we kept it in our function. So So let's see how we can clean this up. Well, we see that this one can be reduced and just leave an x in that denominator. And we can factor out an e to the sine x squared. And what we have left is 3 over x plus 2x ln of x cubed cosine x squared. And always factor out to clean up for your final answer. Our last problem will be a quotient rule problem. It will be y equals x cubed minus 1 over cosine of x squared. So we will have to use our quotient rule as well as our chain rule as we do this problem. So y prime will equal square the denominator. Then we have the denominator, cosine of x squared, times the derivative of the numerator, which is in this case 3x squared. And then we're going to minus the numerator and take the derivative of the denominator. So the cosine of x squared, we first take the derivative of cosine, which is negative sine of x squared. We are going to multiply that by the derivative of the x squared, which is 2x. Cleaning up a little bit, we can factor out an x, and then we will have 3x cosine of x squared plus x cubed minus 1 sine of x squared, and all of that is multiplied by a 2, over cosine of x squared squared. We could write that as cosine squared x squared. And we can multiply through by this 2, but it really isn't important for us because there's no way we can factor out anything else. So this gives us the final problem that we have on product rule, quotient rule, chain rule, and very, very important topic in dealing with calculus. This concludes your lesson on chain rule.